Hello.
Well, thank you everybody for being here. And thanks for caring about the 240 P test suite and MDFourier. Obviously, the suite is not a one-person job. Although I try to code every version that I can, there's always help from others. There's the graphic design, which I am really bad at. When it grew up, my friend Asher here helped out with the basic layout back then. And over the time, it's been the help of a lot of people, and several of them are here. So thank you very much. I'll try to mention some of you, but it's way too much. It's way too much help to get a product like this, because I'm not an expert on every system, and I'm not an expert on every pattern or use. So I'm not an expert on anything. I'm just working on several things at once and getting feedback to get the product, the suite, the best as possible. It's even though in games I hate patches, the 240p test suite gets a lot of them, because it's in a process of a constant update. I made mistakes. There are improvements. There are suggestions. There are requests. And of course, there are new tests that the community comes up with and I can implement. And well, that's incredible, because the suite wouldn't be at this stage if that wasn't the case. Okay. So we're going to talk about MDFourier and the suite, and how both things have tried to help in several areas, right? The first thing is, what is it? Okay, what's the 240p test suite? And it is, first of all, open source and free. That means that you can check out the source to any of the versions. Thankfully, all I've done, and also all that other people have made themselves, which is amazing, for every single platform. This has a dual purpose. The first one was for other people to contribute patches and improve the suite by itself. And the second one was to have, obviously this was 10 years ago, proper examples, well not proper, some examples on how you could code for these platforms and have like graphics and basics for creating a game. Because even though the suite seems quite basic, it has the very elemental parts of a game. You draw things to the screen, you scroll, you can move the sprites, you change palettes, and make sound, sometimes music, and so on and so on. So it was an exercise as well for me to learn the internals of each one of these systems in order to have a working example. One thing I didn't mention starting that I had in mind was, please, at any moment, if anybody of you has a comment or a question regarding any of these areas, just raise your hand, and we'll make a parenthesis and talk about that area, okay? Yeah? No. Just scratch it. So, the second thing is that it's free. Of course, it's obvious that I started Patreon a couple of years ago. It's something I didn't want to do, but it helps out. Okay, it helps out because of materials and because of acquiring stuff, basically, which is needed, like equipment, vector scopes, and the like. Yeah?
The first console it was on
was the Sega Genesis and Mega Drive back in 2011. It was February. And basically, I wanted to check the XRGB Frame Master, because I was an avid user of the XRGB2 and the XRGB3. And I used those on BGA CRTs, right? And some HDTVs that did have no lag BGA ports back in the day. It was a completely different time, even though it seems so close. And I wanted to know if all the promises from the XRGB Frame Master were true, like the aspect ratio and the colors. And the only way to verify it, because I didn't have some, was to create. And what I did was create a couple of patterns. The first one were the grid, the checkerboard, and the drop shadow test. Okay, and those were built in order to check precisely if 240p was properly displayed and if the upscaling of the frame history was proper to whatever I could approximate. Because even though I had a background in video broadcast, it's not the same. However, I was an avid enthusiast about calibrating my display and audio, so I had access to, you know, the DVD Text Annex or Digital Video Essentials and Avia and all that stuff. So I was inspired to that, but it was interesting to think that you could be inside the console and have it do whatever you want and test from both sides, because on a DVD player, you only have the output, and with the console, the main console, you have control of what's going on. So that was interesting. So yeah, it's open source and free, and it's under GPL right now. Okay, and I hope it stays that way. And it's a set of tools created to work under several scenarios. It originally was created to check on how schedulers were working, but I immediately noticed the need to use it for CRT calibration, of course. And I started working on that with people that knew and know way much more than I do to try and have patterns that would be useful in those scenarios. And there are certain things that it has demonstrated to work that weren't exactly the idea back when it was created, but it has grown, and it is a good idea for streamers to have a validation of their chain. So if you have digitized the video signal and follow all your path, you can check the aspect ratio, the colors, the balance, and the processing of the 240p signal, right? So it's something that I do every time I try to run the stream. I do basic checks, so I don't go wild on it. I just check that the aspect ratio is fine, that whites are fine, it's not getting crushed, and I go with it, right? But something that you can do to check. Obviously, it's directly related to video capture and upscaler processing and testing, because the whole chain is there. And another use is obviously emulation and preservation. Now, with the precision the FPGA, like Mr. FPGA, gets us, it's something that I'm really glad that the Mr. team, for example, has been using to test and validate comparing the real console to what the Mr. does. And for instance, Risha is here, and she's been working a lot. She's amazing at that, and she's been a developer that's been using it in several cases. And it helps in a way, because when you run the emulator, you can check if the aspect ratio is proper, if levels are proper, zero. It's a way to compare the vintage implementation to current implementations, and even between older implementations, like Model 1 Genesis versus a Model 2 Genesis. Are they the same? Are they not? So having reference test patterns is something that I push for. Like, I'd like to, I don't know, if you have to check that you want to check how the scanlines look on a PBM, you can take a screenshot of a white screen, a black screen, a red screen, and then compare that to the upscaler and have a baseline. It's not like it's the have them and kill every other option. It's like a baseline option to have a similar output that you can compare on either setup, right? Then obviously it's the CRT users. And finally, it's related to what I was saying, it's video game preservation, right? Because you can check, sorry, what the signal is supposed to look like from the original console, and compare that to your output for the future. So even though if we get to a point where the game console is no longer working, we don't have an example, the intention is to have the output of the console documented in some way with reference patterns to try and recreate how they looked on older technology and from the original console, okay? This, of course, is a hard problem, because you have to have formats and documentation that also age, right? If you have a JPEG image, will it be possible to open a JPEG image in 40 years? Who knows, right? Now, how does it help to achieve these kind of goals? It has, we have here the 2-3 bit test suite from the Super Nintendo running on this PBM, thanks Steve RetroTech. And well, it has several menus, but it has test patterns. That's what we were looking for. And well, here I mentioned color calibration, brightness, geometry. I don't intend to go in detail into any one of these, but if you have any questions, just feel free to yeah.
Who's the guy on the menu?
Well, it's a. I'm a big fan of Snatcher. Okay. Yeah. So there's this guy called Gillian Seed, and he appears in a version for the MSX2. That's SD Snatcher, and a very familiar version of Gillian Seed looks somewhat like that. But here, my friend Asher modified it so I could use it. Okay, so yeah, that's it. And well, you have color calibration that ranges, like you get the color bars and you have to set up to see every single grade of color in the display so you don't crush color or you don't lose the low end. This is usually not where you start, but I'm running with what I wrote. Notes. You have the brightness and contrast options where you have to balance the black. So you guarantee that you're seeing the darkest black that each console can output. Of course, this is variant and dependent on the console that you're using. And the most precise or more precise the console that you're using, the better it will be according to standards. But the goal of each version of the suite is to document each platform. So these are the lowest values that the Super Nintendo can do. And as a matter of fact, one of those bars that you're not seeing right now, because it can change between levels, but it'll be really difficult to see here, is a blue, because the darkest or the color with the least illuminance in the Super Nintendo is a blue, okay, instead of a gray. That's kind of funny. But that's why it's selected, and we go through those and improve them. Maybe I made a mistake, and that blue is not the darkest color. So far, nobody's reported that, but it was the other way around. It was like, there's a darkest color than that gray that you have. Ah, okay, which one? This one. And we changed it so that you are not losing any detail when you calibrate. So in this scenario, you raise the brightness of the display until you see three bars that are on the sides, three on each side, and then you lower it until the first one, the closest to the center, just disappears into the background. And that's the proper way, just disappears. That's the proper way to tell that you have black level calibrated, right? And that's brightness. And the same when in a CRT, you have bloom between that white, and you have that white not to get bloomed. And that way you have color and contrast somewhat calibrated. We have the color bars, we have the PAL and the NTSC version of those, and then the each primary, just as I mentioned, and it has an option, this one, to toggle between a white and a dark background, because sometimes in some CRTs that makes the whole thing change. So it's a way to try and test, and every version has differences here because the signals are different, and it's whatever most appropriate was felt at the time, or I forgot something. Then you have this pattern. This was basically lifted off from Avia, and you use color gels that are just color films that you place between your eyes and the screen on your usual either lights or no lights conditions. And you balance the colors. You see patterns here that follow the primaries, right? If you're using a blue gel, that would be the. I believe this one has a blue check. I'm a bit. I can't see very well, so let me check.
This one has. Now, blue only won't work
on RGB. Yeah, dumb me. But if you have a composite, you can use blue only and turn off the guns. You can also turn off the guns. I'm not going to do that right now. But with the gels, you place them between your eyes and the screen, and you'll see patterns. In this case, the blue gels will get you kind of like a squares, okay? Because the colors cancel. And with the red, you'd get other pattern, and with the green, you get other pattern. The wiki documents which pattern you'll see. And the colors that are being blocked should have the same brightness level. And that way, you get a proper color balance between the three primaries and secondaries. And that's the way that it's supposed to be used. Those gels, you can get those from old calibration DVDs on eBay. And or even, sometimes you get those THX blue glasses, and you get, we usually only calibrate to blue, because green is impossible to calibrate, because we see green way better. That's, you know, 444, 422, so. And blue is the one that we see the less, so it's easiest to calibrate, and red is the in-between. Yeah, sorry.
Is it standard color temperature blue, like CTV gels, or is there a specific?
It should be for every, we use like 65,000. No, well, 6,500. English is different, because in Spanish we say the thousands. Sorry, but yeah. And it's funny that you mentioned that, because in Japan, they use 9,300, right? So, well, it's up to you. I go for 93, but it's up to the user.
That's pretty much.
Okay, got it. And this is a color bleed, and the color bleed is intended mainly for capture, because that color compression, obviously, if you use something that's higher resolution, you'll get the pattern of a compression way better than on 240p. But you can use, for example, the Dreamcast version that has this pattern in 480, and it has primaries and secondaries. So you can see how 422 is destroying information on the patterns while compressing, right? Yeah, I don't know. It also helps you check the bloom between colors, because you have the option to turn this into checkerboard or just vertical bars. Other things that it has, because I my intention was not to go into detail for those, is pixel sampling, the geometry, which is what remember this here. And for geometry, we have Kit's new monoscope pattern that is easier to use than the one that I had, because these are squares, and it's easier to measure a square than a circle all across. And these are calculated with a lot of detail by Keith, and I try to help out so that based on the pixel clock and the NTC standard and his professionally calibrated equipment, we get the same width and height as close as possible millimetrically to what his results are on a CRT that's been calibrated to spec by himself with new caps and a scope, everything. And here you can lower or raise the brightness of the luminance of the background, and you can just measure that. I use a piece of tape and then measure, or a piece of paper. You mark it, turn it, and you can tell if the aspect ratio is correct. This should be squares, not rectangles. In memory, if you run it in an emulator in pixel perfect, or if you are using pixel perfect scaling, you'll get rectangles that are just squashed. If you want to get the proper aspect ratio, they should be squares. And that's the way that you can confirm those. It's not the only use, but it's the main, most obvious one. I didn't mention it, and you probably all know this, but everything has help, right? Every single pattern, if you go inside it and press, select this four. If you press start, you get the help for every one of those. Obviously, you won't be able to read from here, but you get some information how to use the pattern and what's supposed to be doing there. Okay, we also have audio tests, hardware tests, but these things are verified. Just as I mentioned, the Monoscope is verified by Keith, and we also verify this with vector scopes. And in that case, that's an oscilloscope, and it's using the audio sync test. This test is useful for streaming, for example, or for checking your capturing and audio chains, because what it does, it plays a beep for exactly, or as close as exactly, one frame. So you capture it, and you should see a white full screen and a tone, and they should be perfectly on sync within one frame. And this has been verified, implemented it on hardware with an oscilloscope. And you can see that the starting and ending of the frame. Those holes are there, and when the signal goes from the baseline to the top, that's a white screen in the oscilloscope. So you get a completely white screen and a sine wave, and they are basically the same length. Obviously, there's some microsecond delay between before and after, because it's hard to sync. There are some consoles where they are perfect, and there are some consoles with frame buffer where it's not exactly perfect. But it's the usually the help when you open it, it tells you what's the highest error that we've measured on that test. So that way you can tell how out of phase or out of frame sync it is. Okay. Now, what is 240p video? And we have, of course, Chris from Displays Gamers to explain that for us. Now, he has a video. He has a video where he talks about it, and he also mentions why we shouldn't call it 240p test, 240p video. And he has a point, but it's the umbrella term that we use for this low bandwidth progressive scan signal that we are used to in video games, right? And just as a small summary, it's of course analog video, it's progressive, and why did they do this? And the answer is kind of simple if you go like 40 years back. They saved a lot of memory, and they save a lot of processing power, right? Because they were drawing just half of the screen vertically, at least, and same thing horizontally. And besides that, you get a very stable image where text can be read quite easily as opposed to 480i. So it was a kind of win-win situation, and that stayed that way for decades. And that brings us to what is MDFourier, okay? And that's kind of hard to explain. MDFourier is a set of software tools that are run in different places. I'm going to explain how it's done, that output a set of graphics, a set of plots, that can help you diagnose or at least figure out what are the differences between two inputs. So you give two inputs to this analysis software, and it generates a set of PNGs, of graphics images, where an empty image would be a perfect match. So it plots differences. If you see a very active plot, that means those are very different signals. If you see a completely empty plot, it's a perfect match. Okay? And what does it compare basically, but not exclusively? It compares timing, okay? Because what it does is, use not always, but mostly the frame rate of the console as basis for comparison. And I'll get into this a bit later, but you can't get away with this on a musical instrument unless it's played by a computer. That's why probably this kind of analysis was not used, or is not commonplace used in other areas. But here, we have very precise clocks that drive the signals. A Mega Drive, a Sega Master System, a Super Nintendo, whatever, they can create the sound, and we can stop them and start these sounds and control where they start and where they stop, and just sync them and compare them with a lot of precision. So very few seconds, if not milliseconds, of sound are needed on each note to contrast the pitch and the amplitude between these, okay? But it also compares timing, because when it does this comparison, it's expecting a certain length. And it can determine, based on that, if there was a discrepancy. This discrepancy could be either between the two machines or even the audio capture, right? So it's just, as I was saying, it's useful to compare different models of consoles, like you compare Sega Super Nintendo Junior to a regular Super Nintendo. You compare a Model 1 to Model 2 Genesis. You compare a PC Engine to a Turbo Graphics, a Wii versus a GameCube, and an emulator versus another emulator, or as a target reference console. Obviously, you can compare capture cards, since I mentioned that it detects the difference. So it doesn't matter if you're comparing one recording to the other or one console to the other. You can use that to figure out what the differences are even between the capture devices. It can compare mods, so if you, and repairs. So if you do a cap service on the motherboard, you can check if there was any difference caused by that service. The answer is it usually doesn't, unless it was wrong. I mean, if it was non-operational or slightly damaged, then it usually gets back to stock. But if you just like change them for no reason, it usually doesn't do a thing if everything was on spec. Emulators, as I said, audio equipment, capture cards, and audio filters. If you have like equalization, the result of plotting the two different things would be the plot of the equalization with all the valleys and peaks. It's one other thing that's interesting to test is noise floor. So you get to compare AV cables. This is a touchy subject because it's not about saying this is better, this is worse. It's about finding out what's wrong with some hum that you are usually having, or what part of the audio video chain is introducing the noise. Sometimes you change power supplies and you can see that the noise disappears. And this helps you plot in the spectrum where that's located at, because it tries to give some guidelines. When it outputs this plot, it tells you what's the refresh console, refresh from that console, and it plots a slight line on top of that, so you can match that and see if there are peaks there or not. Same thing with the video refresh, general video refresh, and the power supply that you're using. So it matches 60 hertz, 15 kilohertz, and 7 point whatever it is, depending on the console. And this helps also check AV cable shielding, because you can compare it like a stock composite cable that's plugged and no shielding to one of the cables that we have now, thanks to this wonderful community that does things that were way beyond the best that was available during the console release. And you can see how much things drop, right? Even by connecting a CRT, you can see you connect it, record it, disconnect it, record it, and check how much noise the CRT being connected, being plugged to the console introduces to the audio. And well, how is this achieved? You have three parts. You have a tone generator. Okay, this is the thing that generates the patterns. In our case, it's here. It's a 240p test suite. Has an option to just run it. It's a bare bones screen. Just tells you to press A. Okay, but this is the tone generator, and what it does is create a set of screens to a set of screens, a set of tones. It does at first. It creates what I call a pull stream, but for lack of a better name, and it just kept it way. I play a single tone for a frame, then are silent. I play silent, and it does it 10 times, and at the end the same thing. That way, the software can just raster the complete audio file and figure out where those 10 pulses are and align it to with a very, very high precision. When I made this, I honestly didn't think that it would be as precise as it is, and I thought it was presumptuous and pedantic to give it so much importance, and it has demonstrated to be accurate to like 1/4 of a microsecond. So it's impressive how when it works. Obviously, it's when there's a lot of noise, it's harder to get that. But it sounds completely obvious and stupid, but I'm impressed on how good mathematics and physics are. And well, it does that. It syncs the start of the signal, the end of the signal. You get the pulses, and it has a graph where it shows you how well aligned the frames are to the audio, and you can verify visually at a glance if the detection of the pulses was proper. Obviously, you can do that manually if you want to. Just open a DAW, get the samples, and tell the software where to start and when to stop, and do analysis. If you have a very noisy signal, like on a Commodore 64, you get very noisy signals. So it's sometimes best to go that way. But it tries to be fully automatic. And as I mentioned, you have the tone generator that's usually part of the 240p test suite. Sometimes it's standalone. You have an audio interface that would be to digitize your audio, right? And you have the analysis software, which is also open source, and it runs on macOS, Linux, and Windows. It's fully written in C99-ish kind of ANSI C. So it compiles. I've even compiled it in the X68000, so it works. And it's so slow there. But it's the intention as is for it to be part of a preservation effort. So it in itself is not that difficult to preserve, I hope. And executables are static and linked based on that same philosophy. So you can just grab the executable, and as long as you have an x86 or x64 processor, it'll run statically on either on those platforms. Just for making it easier, because I found so many times I want to use a tool, and it's so hard to get all the environment to run, even though it's primitive. There's also a front end for Windows and for macOS. Linux users know their way. And you can just drag and drop and run, and that's it, right? This is a sample output. You know, it's very small, but you get like middle green line and several lines that tell you differences. Differences are in volume, decibels, amplitude, really, which tell you how far away, higher to the top or lower through the bottom, the signals are. In this case, we're comparing two Genesis systems, and the green is the FM, and the aqua-ish line, cyan, is the PSG. And you can see that between these systems, PSG is almost identical in a way, because difference, each mark that you see is 3 decibels. So the difference in PSG is way less than 1 decibel if you average them. But FM has a different equalization. It is between, I believe it was between a model 1 and model 2, but you get different equalization. And what this tells you is that in the model 1, you have, model 2 has a 3 decibel lower PSG than it was on the model 1, because we're using the Genesis as reference. You can as well select it the other way around, because you select which one is a reference. This was designed under the philosophy that nothing is really right. You decide which one you want to be the right thing you are comparing to, and the other thing you are comparing against to, right? So if you plot them, they'll be switched. But there are some things that do change, because it tells you, also it has other graphs that tell you how different they are in terms of stuff that was in the original one that isn't in your copy or your comparison file. And it also tells you which things are in the comparison file that weren't in the original file. So that way you can easily discard stuff, because this only gets you differences. It's like plotting Venn diagrams. If you have a Venn diagram, this is the coincidence. Okay, it's the middle of both circles, and you can have the other halves to have a complete idea of what's going on. And where is it available? Available? It's available in NES. That's by Pinovac. He's an awesome developer that's also done the Game Boy version. There's also Sega Master System. The suite is available for 32X. Dustin is working on the MDFourier. Well, not working now, but will be working, I know, and I'll be helping. But the 32X was just released. This is meant to be for about the suite and MDFourier as a group. It's on Sega Genesis, Mega Drive, Sega CD, PC Engine, PC Engine CD, PC Engine Super CD-ROM, Super NES, Super Famicom, Sega Dreamcast. Dreamcast VMU has MDFourier right now. Yeah. Yes. Not really, unfortunately, because the thing is how it boots. It's just like a game, same thing. If you boot with a 32X, And it's a Genesis version, it will boot into the Genesis version. But what you can do, or we could theoretically possibly do, is boot from Sega CD version and have Genesis and 32X, right? Running as a 32X and having the Genesis layer do their things, the 32X doing their things, and the Sega CD doing their things. But if you run like from the Genesis, it's interesting that you mentioned it, because I do have, in this latest release, tests for the Sega CD from the Genesis card. It's kind of always been there. It's meant as a diagnosis. The 240p test suite also has tools for hardware testing. So if you boot the Genesis card, you get a RAM test for the Sega CD, you get a boot test for the Sega CD now, and check on the BIOS. You can also check the PCM RAM from the Sega CD, work RAM and word RAM so far, and the flags. All the communication flags can be tested. This is because so many Sega CDs have issues, and for repairs, it helps a lot to just put from the cart and try to check as much as possible there, because you have also have a memory viewer, and well, the latest is that it boots the Sega CD, it sends a code to the Sega CD, executes the code in assembly on the Sega CD, checks the RAM, returns the values, and tells the Genesis. And that's like in steps. I want to do it a bit more detailed and more stepwise for release, but the pre-release that's over there in GitHub already has this. But yeah, it's dependent. If the hardware has access to, then yes, some things can be done. Right now, the 32X version doesn't use the Genesis layer. It's purely 32X. But Dustin plans to add support for the Genesis layer and check out how they combine. Okay. Now, there's also GameCube and Wii. MDFourier is ready. Extremes helped me develop that. He was really interested in checking out cables, and he did an extensive analysis on cables and encoders and upscalers and GC Digital and everything that he's posted at his site using MDFourier. And unreleased version of MDFourier. If somebody needs it, I just can send it. It's just ugly. But it'll be prettied up and released, hopefully, this year. And we also have X68000 MDFourier. Yeah.
I was saying, is there any plans for any sort of like MDFourier equivalent for analog video rather than analog audio?
I'd love to. Thing is, first of all, I know it's possible. I just believe I'm incapable of understanding what I need to understand to do it. And this is completely honest. It overwhelms me to do a multidimensional Fourier analysis, even though it's kind of in the name. But it's not intended to be multidimensional Fourier. but yeah, you'd have to do that. You'd have to do multidimensional Fourier. It could be just like triplicating the workflow and the analysis, but thing is, you'd need perfect analog 444 captures and analysis over that for it to be worth something. But yes, it's completely possible. I'm just not at that point. Neither is my computer. And I'm pleased to say that it's been used in a bunch of things. I probably missed several of them. But as I mentioned, Mr. FPGA uses it. And one thing I'm really happy that Trisha back there implemented is a system to add audio filters on any core. She made it global, and this is amazing because it means that we can figure out the filters for any future system, and they could be implemented as a text file that gives the parameters, and we can use it. So please, a round of applause to Risha for that. it's been used, obviously, in the triple bypass that Tianfeng, Werner, Mavius, obviously Bob, and Craig, et cetera, many people have been working in, and it's great. That's a matter of fact, that's The second reason, and the most important, that this thing got pushed from just an experiment to something that's workable, because we were working as a team when this happened. Yes?
So what's your favorite retro game soundtrack?
Streets of Rage 2. One is a big contender, and several others, but
3 is pretty good too.
Yeah, it is. But it's so experimental, many people just...
That's what I like about it. Yeah, that was a good choice.
Yeah, the Shinobi, yeah. So they worked on it, and they were very encouraging, because we were when the first version of MDFourier, it was coded in a week, and it just gave numbers. So it kind of makes sense to me, but I wasn't sure it was doing what it was doing. And they said, "Oh yeah, like these numbers is too much information." It was like, I don't know, a 2K file of just raw text telling you the differences between each one of the frequencies. So it was crazy. So it was changed to PNGs, and that automatically made it simpler. And we experimented also with different audio cards, because we didn't know if this was something that we could replicate. But the instant that Bob digitized using a different audio interface, I did the same, and the results between two Genesis Model 1s matched. That was magical, because we understood that it meant something, right? It was just not a crazy dream. There was a bit of uncertainty there, because I measured it the next day and it was completely off. And you know what it was? It was temperature. It was that day was a very hot day at my place. And it was like 5-10 degrees, I'm going to say Celsius now, but it was 5 or 10 degrees Celsius higher than the usual. And it reached like 90 degrees Celsius inside of the console. And that was completely off spec for an 85 degree capacitor. And the right channel was low pass filtered, and left channel was just high pass filtered. It was so strange, and I was going crazy, because what did I do? I just went back with GitHub? No, everything's good, okay? And I rerun my checks, everything's good. And it was temperature. I just placed a fan, and everything went flat again, right? I went with the heat gun, everything was screwed up. Okay, good, we have control, right? There's the blog has made the ChipSync products, which David's input has been impressive. Tianfeng and Bob and Bernard have been an impressive help in making this happen, because they've always believed in it, and they helped me just like put things in better terms. And David is a power user that from day one, when he noticed it, how it goes, he simply started needing a more professional interface, more professional features. And what about 1 gigahertz sample files? Okay, and it could manage them, because I don't use any library to read the audio. I do it in C, so I honestly didn't expect it to work. It worked. And he just goes with a 2 gigahertz, 5 gigahertz sample for the NAS, and we compare it directly from the scope or the logic analyzer, and we compare it to the audio capture, and they match. So that's awesome. And he makes these incredible products. If any of you are into using virtual synthesizers, he has MDFourier developed with a Mega Drive, Famicom, Super Famicom as well. Which are very similar to the ones that we have on Mister, right? We have the analog pocket that we corrected a few issues that were present with some notes on release, and it was really fast. We detected that there was some timing difference. I don't remember, it's documented in the site. So much has happened. But luckily, it was just like reported and fixed the next day, right? Being in the subject, it's important to notice that this MDFourier makes sense, obviously, in the timing area, but also the analog part of the audio out of the console is much what it tries to document and pursue, right? You may see plots comparing like analog to Mister, And I want to touch on the subject just to say that it's a difference, a complete difference in philosophy. Okay, Mister tries to replicate the complete chain and it gives you the option to change the filters and select the kind of system you want to simulate, right, or emulate, or create, whatever. And analog doesn't. Analog, they have a firm belief in the digital signal of the console and not the analog part of it, okay? And that's purely ideological, because it's perfect in the digital sense, as far as we can tell, okay? There's also the 60-bit audio fault project that is run by DeLuca, and it's amazing because they document music, they digitize the music for the game, so it is now part of the process to check the audio interfaces that their contributors are using, and also the consoles that they are recording from. They can verify that they comply to a certain degree with the model that they are, that we everybody else has in the community. So they can use this as part of their process to verify the contributions so that we have recordings that are equivalent to a certain degree, right? Obviously, as I mentioned, Mr. FPGA has NES, Famicom, PC Engine, Sega Genesis, Mega Drive, obviously, and Super Nintendo. The Pack Attack that's just been released for the Laser Active. There has been also a mod to improve the audio with that. And Provenance Emu, the guy that develops this, and this is on Apple devices, he has matched the PC Engine audio with MDFourier to his target the platform, and that's awesome. And Extremes also has made this GameCube results that he has in the wiki. And you can check out all cables between GameCube and Wii and how audio differs in every aspect. He's documented all. You have the curves, you have the missing, the extra, and the noise floor on each one of those. Why is it important? It's a common belief that we have everything figured out, right? Yes, please. Sorry, I hadn't seen. Oh, no. We believe that, we all have believed at some point that everything has been documented. And this brings me back to the time that, for instance, it was pointed to us that the PC Engine color palette was off, right? That the composite was different than the RGB one. And once again, we worked with Risha, with David Chadoff, with Furtek, and Bernard, Mike Chi, and a lot of other people involved, and it was very intense, and yes, the colors were wrong, right? And this was like how many years, right? And the same thing for this, like the Super Nintendo, and this was a rediscovery because we were working, David from Plog and myself, on the Super Nintendo MDFourier pattern, and this is one of the reasons that's not released, even if I've had it for 2 years ready. Is that Super Nintendo audio changes based on temperature alone. And I'm talking about 2 degrees Fahrenheit and it changes pitch. So that's kind of hard to just impose on the user, right? Because if you are comparing two Super Nintendos and the temperature slightly changed, it's all over the way, all over the place, yes. It's the ceramic oscillator.
The what?
The oscillator, the clock, basically. So this is very interesting because even if you have a Toslink mod, the optical audio out, it's gonna have jitter, okay? It's gonna be different. And the thing is that it reports as 32,000 when you send it via optical, but it isn't. Okay, that's why some audio receivers have some issues with that, because in reality it's receiving it with a lot of jitter. It's like 32,087 or 127. Or we made stats, we made a spreadsheet with all our values, we measured them with the scopes, I raised and lowered temperatures and checked and plotted how it differed with this, and we used the thermal camera. And then found that obviously you had found this like 10 years ago, and it was reported in a forum, and I decided upon a figure and just went with it, because if you go to the spec of 32,000, the games crash, because no Super Nintendo runs at 32,000, okay? And the communication was off. And this is because just that ceramic oscillator. But MDFourier now has two ways to deal with this, but it's complicated, because you have to enter a flag for it to figure out what's the difference between the two signals, and then it expands or compresses the other signal to match in time to what it's supposed to be, and then compares them. And it works. It works surprisingly well, but it's complicated, and I don't want it to be so complicated for such a mainstream console. So I've not released that, and David created a test that's way more detailed than I have. I must stress this, I'm no expert. I'm going blindly into this. I learn as I go. And I wish that all the times there was some expert on each console that could just tell me how the synth works, not because I'm lazy, and I am. It's also the fact that they know so much more. And the times that I've had an expert by my side when we design the tests, it's like 2 days, and we get an amazing test that stresses the differences between models, what can be done, what emulation usually does wrong, etc. And when I do it, it's just like a frequency sweep and basic tests, and I understand how the chips work and do those for every one of those, and very basic, right? I'm slow. But when expert is available, it's amazing. And obviously, this insights that if anybody can contribute and create a better test pattern, please do so. They are basic. When they're done by this by myself, they're basic. They give just the basics about amplitude, frequency, and timing. They won't give you the stress cases as David can on the Super Nintendo. And as Pinovac did with the NES, yes.
Since you need hitting strings for every single console, right?
Sorry,
you need hitting strings for every console.
Exactly, and it's interesting that you mention it, because on the GameCube and Wii and Dreamcast, we use the audio equipment test. That's a test based around the CD in general, the CD format, just 44, 48. As 182, etc. kilohertz PCM audio, and we use that as a base test on GameCube and Wii, because that's a stress test for digital audio in general. So it's worked really well for that. And then it's no, we haven't figured everything out. So this is about figuring things out, like those details that were already some found out, but we didn't know about it, or they weren't as mainstream known, right? And I believe, and this is something we were talking about, that if we have access now, we also have, as a community, the responsibility for people in the future to have access to most documentation on how things were. Because, I don't know, 30 years from now, will there be a working Game Boy out there? I mean, we can repair them and get to a point, but even if you repair them, are those tantalum capacitors equivalent to the electrolytic ones you were using acoustically? And that's kind of the idea, right? Every time, because we need to physically preserve, we need to preserve in FPGA code, we need to know that when those implementations are transferred to future hardware, to future emulation, future operating systems, we can verify them against the reference and tell that we haven't lost as much, because obviously if my test patterns are very basic, there is a lot to go between the cracks, right? But it's the best that we can do, I believe. It's a kind of a responsibility. Now, regarding that, the quest for perfection, I believe it won't be achieved ever, like 100% perfection, but why? And the thing is that even between the same system, same consoles, they don't match at 100%. These are analog devices, there are deviations, there are differences, and there are so much revisions for each console. Like, you know that the SNES Junior has different glitches than the original one, and these are official implementations. There's always gonna be differences, and we can strive to document each one of those as best as we can. But as we go creating homebrew for consoles, we will reach circumstances that don't run in the original hardware, but run in the emulator. I found those conditions in my quest for creating the 240p test suite in almost all platforms. And this is very basic software in many ways. Like, I don't know, in the Sega CD, I coded it in the hardware, worked, and it mainly didn't work. And the other way around. It's simply that some things are shortcuts. And the shortcuts make some homebrew run on the emulator and not in real hardware. So yes, it's very difficult, or I believe impossible, to reach absolute perfection, because if it's software and it's hardware. And it's kind of demonstrated that a system will always have bugs, right? So let's just accept that, and we can try. We can try, and we can achieve as most as possible as a group, I believe. And what's in the future for these things? I'd love to port MDFourier for arcade PCBs. Okay, I'm slow again, but I'm getting there. The BMU helped. Computers, imagine how it would be to have Sound Blaster and Sonic, right, and the MIDI synths, and well, all audio hardware out there, or PC88 and PC98, and have those with that precision, and all synths in the arcade PCBs. And what's needed? We need developers, we need experts, we need enthusiasts. So any help is welcome. And well, that's it. Thank you very much. And I don't know if you got any questions. Thank you.
Panel earlier mentioned if you had those weeks off, you'd maybe look at doing a Neo Geo, right? Does NG Dev Kit provide everything you would need to do that, or not even sure?
No, there's the tools are there.
Okay.
I just don't have the knowledge.
Yeah.
But I'm working on that, because my Neo Geo is it's something that we all want. They provided us the tools back there. Jose and Movius provided a card for me to develop. I have the hardware. Thing is, the SDK just was maturing like 1 or 2 years ago into something very, very good, and they already have it. But I need to polish my C80 assembly for the audio test. And having done the BMU, I believe I can tackle. It's way easier to code for the C80 than for the BMU.
I've taken a crack at it, I believe you.
Do you think one day in the future, like the Mister and the analog consoles might be able to emulate the exact models? Like, for example, there might be a Model 1A where it had high definition graphics on the console. Like, emulate that, or emulate Model 2 or Model 3.
Risha, can you tell him?
Well, the Mister right now actually can do the Model 1 and the Model 2, and it has a couple of the different filters for each of those two, or you can sort of get rid of most of the filter if you want it to sound very, like, clean. So to some extent, yes. Or, for example, on the NES, if you want it to sound like it's RF audio, you can throw, like, a 2 kilohertz filter on there. So you can emulate a lot of the different variations.
Thanks.
That was the most polite nerd flex I've ever heard in my life.
Well, someone else? Yes.
You mentioned that there's so much variation that it may never be possible to get a true database. But what if you make that a feature that you could record certain parameters of a variant of the console and fingerprint it? So you kind of crowdsource that, right? You run it on your console. If it matches an existing fingerprint very closely, you say, great, now I'm sure which one I have. If it doesn't match one very closely, you contribute it, and maybe later somebody else has the same fingerprint, and you together can help figure out what that variant is.
Yeah, you can do that, as a matter of fact. Thing is that currently only some of my recordings and some other contributors are up there. Originally, I didn't want to be like imposing a set of things to define what's what, right? I always wanted to distance myself from that. I understand that I'm already in this position. But I don't want to work as much to create the database and keep it up because I won't be able to progress in the other stuff. I know it's necessary, but I can just split myself so much. Part of the idea some people suggested. Huh?
That he should do that.
No, the code is in C, so in a way it could be ported to a web service kind of easily, and have a web service to have such a database. And but it's a massive amount of data. But yeah, it's been suggested. I hate developing web, and I'm not good at. I do a lot of archivile, but I'm not good at it. I just do it because I have to. So that's the main reason. If somebody wants to help me with that, that would be amazing. But yes, it would be valuable. It was suggested by David from Plog to use the archive arc as a repository for recordings that we have based on the audio card and the hardware that we have, and you could like fingerprint them. But something on top of what we have, other than visually examining them, because I was kind of adamant on not giving a number as a grade, right? I left it to interpretation on giving all the data as much as possible on the screen. And to have automatic matches, it kind of have to have a grade, a number that it could be reduced to, so that and it can be done. Of course, I just didn't want to pursue that, but it's in there because that was the original intent. So yes, it could be modified for that, and yes, I can see the value on that. Thank you. Yes.
For 480p and 1080p test suite.
For 480p, you have Dreamcast and Wii. And there is a specific patterns for that, and Dreamcast One, as far as I know, has all the 480p ones that I could figure out. It has Donna in 480p, it has grids, it has Monoscope, it has the laser gun test, the gun test in 480p as well.
1080p test suite?
Oh. You can just use PNGs.
I have used PNGs. I base it on your batteries.
There you go. Yeah, but maybe someday. I have so much to do that I want to do, and I'm slow. But it would be amazing. If someone wants to do it, I can help on that, of course. Okay? Well, thank you. Thank you all, my friends. Roman, he's lent me a whole bunch of equipment from him to this, and Lex, and everybody. Bob, thank you very much for Corey, Ry. They've helped so much. They made an awesome video for it. Of course, Chris from Displaced Gamers, Risha, Danielle, everybody has helped a lot. Jose, thank you all. And thank you all for being here. It's been amazing.